Now, enzymes are important because enzymes catalyze reactions. And enzymes are present in all living systems, including our cells, as well as bacteria that might cause problems for us, or even viruses that cause problems. So if we can think of ways of inhibiting enzymes that are specific to bacteria or viruses, then we have a way of helping to improve health because we stop pathogens, for example, from causing problems. Well, as a consequence of that, people are interested in understanding how to inhibit enzymes, because if we can inhibit those enzymes, as I said, for bacteria or viruses, we can stop them from growing. Well, I'm going to talk about a couple of different types of approaches to inhibiting enzymes that I want you to understand. The first of these is fairly intuitive. It's called competitive inhibition, and it's what you see on the screen. On the left side, you can see an enzyme that has bound to a substrate. Okay? That enzyme binding to a substrate, the enzyme has a binding site for it, the enzyme binds it, it catalyzes a reaction. A competitive inhibitor, on the other hand, is a molecule that looks and has a shape very much like the normal substrate for an enzyme, but when it binds to the enzyme can't do anything with it. So this competitive inhibitor is basically occupying the enzyme and keeping the enzyme from working on its normal substrate. Right? So understanding this phenomenon of competitive inhibition is really important. The first thing I will tell you about it is what you see on the screen. Competitive inhibitors of enzymes look like the normal substrate. They have to, because they bind to the same place on the enzyme as the normal substrate. Now, here's a really good example. You can see a molecule on the top known as methotrexate, and on the bottom as dihydrofolate. Okay? Dihydrofolate is a molecule we find in our bodies. Dihydrofolate is used to make molecules called folates that are necessary for making nucleotides. And of course, nucleotides are necessary for making nucleic acids like DNA and RNA. So dihydrofolate is very important for our cells to have. Methotrexate is a molecule that looks very much like dihydrofolate, and it binds to the same enzyme that dihydrofolate binds to. However, because it has a very slightly different structure, the enzyme gets gummed up and doesn't function. Well, methotrexate is actually used to kill cancer cells because it can bind to the enzyme, okay, that's used to make folates and gum it up. Well, if a cell has methotrexate in it, what happens is it can't make folates, it can't make nucleotides, it can't make nucleic acids, and if it can't make nucleic acids, it can't divide. Well, what are cancer cells really good at? Dividing. So, yes, this does affect normal cells, but it preferentially will affect cancer cells because they're dividing more rapidly. So methotrexate is a really good example of a competitive inhibitor that's used for health purposes. Well, what is the kinetic effect of competitive inhibitors on reactions? All right. Well, let's go back to our original plot that we talked about where we had velocity versus substrate concentration. And what I've plotted here are two different things. I've plotted a series of reactions with an enzyme and substrate. So I have an enzyme and a varying amount of substrate, no competitive inhibitor. So I see that this has a V versus S plot. I get up to a V max that you can see as shown right here. We can see that it has a Km value here. There's V max over 2, and there's the Km that corresponds to that. Okay. If I do the same reaction and I add a fixed amount, this is really important. In all of the reactions I do, the 8 or 9 reactions that I'm talking about, I used a fixed amount of inhibitor. And the reason I'm using a fixed amount of inhibitor is because I don't want to have two variables. One variable I have is substrate concentration. So I don't want to vary inhibitor and substrate concentration. I only want to vary substrate concentration. So all the reactions I do in the bottom plot have a fixed amount of inhibitor. Well, what happens to that V versus S plot is what you can see here. That ranges down here, the velocities are lower. But as I keep adding more and more and more substrate, what's happening? Well, the velocity for the inhibited reaction, which is the lower one, is getting closer and closer and closer and closer. And eventually, if I get enough substrate, it will reach Vmax. Why does that happen? Well, it's due to the fact that the substrate and the inhibitor are both competing for the same site. Remember, I have a fixed amount of inhibitor. Okay? So let's imagine I've got 1,000 molecules of inhibitor. Okay? And over here at this low concentration, I've got 1,000 molecules of enzyme. It's a 50-50 chance whether the enzyme is going to bind the inhibitor or the substrate. But over here where I've got very high concentrations of substrate, I might have 1,000,000 molecules of substrate and 1,000 molecules of inhibitor. It's going to be 1,000 times more likely that the enzyme is going to bind to the substrate instead of binding to the inhibitor. Okay? So at infinite concentration of substrate, I'm going to have the same Vmax for the two because the enzyme isn't essentially going to see the inhibitor at all. So when I look at the Vmax for competitively inhibited reactions, they're the same as the Vmax for the uninhibited reaction. Very important point. Now this graph is really good because it illustrates that the Km value, which some people call the apparent Km, but the Km value for the inhibited reaction is different. It increases. Well, remember that increasing Km corresponds to decreasing enzyme affinity. So under competitive inhibition, Km increases, Vmax does not change. If we look at the same information on a Lineweaver-Burk plot, it's not totally surprising what we see. Okay? First, we see this line over here, shown in sort of purple, that's going up like this. That corresponds to the uninhibited reaction. And if we look at the inhibited reaction shown in blue as we go up here, we can see that they're both straight lines, right? But we see a couple of interesting things. First, both lines cross at the same point. They cross at the point of 1 over Vmax. That's not surprising because we determined earlier that the two Vmaxes were identical. So they should have the same value at Vmax. On the other hand, we see that minus 1 over Km is closer to 0. Well, if you take a number and you increase it, okay, you take minus 1 over that, you'll see that that number gets closer to 0. So we can see that the slope of the line on the Lineweaver-Burk plot for the competitively inhibited reaction is steeper. It runs through 1 over Vmax, and the x-intercept is closer to 0. Well, another type of inhibition we need to consider is that of what's called non-competitive inhibition, and it's fundamentally different from competitive. Remember that in competitive inhibition, the inhibitor looked very much like the substrate. And that's because they're both binding to the same site on the enzyme. In non-competitive inhibition, the inhibitor does not look like the substrate, and in fact binds to a different place on the enzyme. Well, what that means is that because they're not competing, there's no way for the non-competitive inhibitor to be outcompeted by the substrate. That is, I can add all the substrate in the world that I want, but since they're not competing for the same site, they're competing for different sites, that there's always going to be a fixed amount of enzyme that's going to be inhibited, no matter how much substrate I add. That wasn't the case for competitive inhibition. Well, what does that mean? It means that in any non-competitive inhibition reaction, a fixed percentage of the enzyme is going to be lost. Well, from what I've talked about in class, I hope you remember that if you decrease the amount of enzyme, you decrease the Vmax. And that's exactly what's shown in this slide. The top graph, the top line, or the top plot, shows the uninhibited reaction, V versus S, like we saw before. And the bottom one shows the non-competitive inhibited reaction. That those two reactions are different. This guy below will have a different Vmax than the top reaction. And as a consequence, non-competitive inhibition has a varying Vmax. It will be lower, okay? Now, something that students commonly find confusing, and I'm not going to go into it too much here, is the fact that the KM value for non-competitive inhibition does not change. And that's because KM is an inherent value of an enzyme. When we have a fixed amount of enzyme being inhibited, we're not changing the amount that's active. Whereas when we were doing the competitive inhibition, the actual amount of enzyme active was changing. Remember, in one case, I had about 50% of the enzyme that was inhibited. At infinite substrate, I had essentially 0%. So the amount of active enzyme was changing. Here, I don't have that. Here, I've got a fixed amount of enzyme being active. Since KM is an inherent function of an enzyme, it won't vary with the amount of enzyme being active. So if I have a fixed amount of active, I will always get the same KM value. If you find that confusing for this class, don't worry about it too much. It's important to know, though, that the KM does not change for non-competitive inhibition. If we look at the non-competitive inhibition Lineweaver-Burk plot, we see something like what's on the screen here. First, we have the purple line that corresponds to the uninhibited reaction that we've seen before. A line crosses at 1 over Vmax, and we see that the two lines, the yellow one or the lighter line of here corresponding to the non-competitively inhibited reaction, we see that they converge at this point right here, the x-axis. Well, what's the value of the x-axis? It's minus 1 over Km. And since the two had the same Km values, it's not surprising that they'll cross at that point. On the other hand, one of the things students find surprising is that the non-competitive inhibition has a higher line than the uninhibited reaction. Why is that the case? Well, remember that the value where the line crosses the y-axis is 1 over Vmax. So 1 over Vmax here, 1 over Vmax here. If you have a smaller number, okay, and you take the inverse of it, you'll get a bigger number. So that's why this line is higher than the uninhibited reaction on a Lineweaver-Burk.